As usual, it is awesome to see so many folks here at History Pub. Thank you, everyone, for being here. We're really excited about tonight's program, and we're really thrilled to have tonight's speakers here to tell us some stories. And also, there's an opportunity tonight. You can put down your contact information and toss it into the fishbowl, and you may be the lucky winner of a one-year family membership to the Oregon Historical Society, which gets you a lot of fantastic benefits in addition to feeling good about supporting our work. And one of those benefits is a subscription to the Oregon Historical Quarterly. All OHS members get that subscription and have continuously since 1900, when the journal first became part of the Oregon experience. I'm really pleased to say that both of tonight's speakers have published in OHQ and may do so again. We would love to have that. We're really pleased to have them both here. Speaking first is going to be Dr. David G. Lewis. He is an independent educator, author, and anthropology researcher who lives in Salem, Oregon, which is in the homeland of his people, the Santiam Kalapuya. He's a member of the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde community of Oregon, and he earned his PhD in anthropology at the University of Oregon with a dissertation that explored the history of the relationship between tribal termination and politics, community, and identity. He's published, as I mentioned, in OHQ, also in the Journal of Western Archives and the online Oregon Encyclopedia, which is published by the Oregon Historical Society. And he also authored a chapter on Oregon tribal history for the book Native America, A State-by-State History. After David will be Dr. Jason T. Younker, who is originally from Coos Bay and is a member of the Coquille Indian Tribe. He is Associate Professor of Anthropology and Assistant Vice President and Advisor to the President for Sovereignty and Government-to-Government Relations at University of Oregon, where he has a ginormous business card. He also earned a PhD in Anthropology at UO in 2003. Prior to returning here to the University of Oregon, he taught for a decade at Rochester Institute of Technology, where he was Chair of the Department of Sociology and Anthropology. He is president of the Association of Indigenous Anthropologists for the American Anthropological Association and was recently honored by the American Indian Science and Engineering Society with their highest award, the Eli S. Parker Award. Please join me in welcoming David Lewis and Jason Younker.
You'll notice that Jason, when he gets up here, is a little taller than I am. But I'm his elder, so he has to look up to me. All right, so here we go. We know that Native stories, what we call oral history now, were history to our lands and peoples back in the day. Many were also teaching lessons for children. Their parents and elders in the tribes would set aside time in winter time, usually at night, to tell stories of the land, how it was formed, and strange animals, the existence of previous races of talking animals, and their trials and tribulations. Many of these stories were designed to teach children how to act and were told to answer questions of how the people got there and who they were in relation to their environment. Most of the stories told everyone that they were part of something larger than they. Once the story was from the Lucky Mute Kalapuya people, my relations. Before I begin, I need to address a pretty stringent rule in Native American society. It's in the telling of oral histories, Native oral histories. It's really almost a law that Native stories be only told in the wintertime and at night. And so, because of that, most of my presentation won't be perhaps a full story. It'll be partial stories, and I'll leave out some of the more gory details. I know you want to hear them, but I really can't. Because we really believe, many people believe, that we tell the story in its totality, that there's power connected to that story, and we could hurt people, so we don't want that to happen. And every tribe has its own way about it, how we do things, so every tribe has its own stories they tell in the summer and winter. So I'm going to start out first with a story that's told by, that's not really told, but heard about the Lucky Mute peoples. It was heard, it was told actually by a tribe of Kalapuya Indians living west of Salem, the Lucky Mute. Their homeland centered around the Lucky Mute River. One of the early settlers in the region, Jesse Applegate, was a boy in around 1844 when he lived among the Lucky Mute. He copied down his adventures later in a book he called Recollections of My Boyhood. His family had settled for a time at Salt Creek, west of the town of Dallas, and he had many adventures with the local native peoples. He recorded a part of the legend of the tribe, which he heard from his native friends. He found they were afraid of a goblin in the Coast Range, Chuchunioff. His entry about this goblin continues. There was a very dangerous goblin in the Coast Mountains, whose awful name was Chuchunioff. When we expressed no fear, saying we would shoot him if we found him, just as we shot a deer or a bear, they said, "His hide is bulletproof, it's hard as iron." Our parents did not seem to regard this story of any consequence. They said it was only an Indian superstition. But my training in the school in the old mission had developed a bump of curiosity in my head, and I absorbed this story eagerly. I had seen that there was an evil spirit roaming around about this earth, and I thought this goblin the Indians told us of might be it. I interviewed many Indians on the subject, but gained little information. I discovered that the low caste Indians truly believed in the existence of a goblin were frightened by it. Their priest, Dickie Dow, said that to fall in the hands of the Chuchunioff would be a fearful thing. This is the Coast Range. Although slow in making the discovery, I eventually learned that there existed among the natives a professional class possessed of all learning not considered necessary in the day affairs of life. These professors were known in the language as Lamashin, that is, medicine men or doctors. They were supposed to be learned in the law and every branch of religious or superstitious character. I became acquainted with two or three professionals, but when I introduced Chuchunioff as a text to be expounded, I found them adverse to discussing the subject without assurance that I was prompted by idle curiosity. This really is the extent of what we know about this goblin. There are no other printed stories that we can find of the myth of the goblin. And because of this goblin, the Lucky Mute would not travel into the Coast Range. When two of the Alfie brothers did so and stayed overnight in the range and returned safely, the native people were much impressed. The stories seemed remarkably similar to stories of other tribes of monstrous demons who live in the tops of mountains. The Klamath would not go to Prairie Lake because of such a story, the place being taboo to them. Even though within their oral history is an account of seeing the formation of Prairie Lake, the story is told as a fight between Shasta and Mazama. Mazama lost the top of the mountain, and the top of the mountain fell inside the crater, and their eyewitness account from about 7,000 years ago tells us much of the consistency of tribal resistance in the area, or residence in the area, sorry. Several of these stories tell the formation of land. These land-changing stories, or changer stories, are known in many forms of many tribes. One such changer story is that of Beaver, who created the Columbia Gorge. He created the gorge by walking down the river and dragging his tail behind him. That's what they say. That's what the elders say. Another story of Beaver has been a great fight with Coyote. Their fighting created the Columbia Gorge, and when Coyote wins, he scatters the parts of Beaver to create the many tribes of peoples in the area. One version of this story has the coastal people created without mouths. Another guy comes along and cuts the mouths for them, but does so imperfectly, which is why their mouths are either too large or imperfect today. This story tells us about the formation of the gorge, an important fishing area for tribes in the region. It's very reminiscent of the more recent glacial story of the region, where geologists have said that about 7,000 years ago or so, the Missoula floods, a massive glacial dam broke, flooding the lower river valleys and bringing the topsoils of eastern Washington into the Willamette Valley, making what we know as the Willamette Valley soils today. Beaver is well known as a powerful river manipulator and maker of dams, and his monstrous version may very well represent the climatic event of breaking the glacial dam, which carved out the gorge and changed the region forever. And in fact, such an event would have scattered the tribes like the parts of Beaver and all areas around the Columbia. This story would have been a great educational tool for all the children in the region. They would then understand and respect the land and how it was formed, and perhaps see other tribes, how other tribes are related to them in some way. Respect for the animals and land and its power was part of Native life. People would initiate ceremonies for weeks at a time where stories of important history would be told. These stories were owned and traded, and storytellers, historians of the tribes, would be groomed from an early age to learn and tell the stories, the histories, without alteration. These important people would carry the history of their people and the tribes, and did so for many thousands of years. Some stories of monstrous human-like creatures are common for this region, such as that of the Stick Indians. Native stories of Stick Indians and notions of the sticks are a likely origin of this expression in America today. Some oral histories represent Stick Indians as fierce and wild humans who were to be avoided. They are known to have magical powers, screamed in strange ways, kidnapped women and children. It's possible that they were scattered tribal groups who lived in the sticks, the forest, and were fierce to the villagers. In tribes, many people did evil things or broke laws. Some would be cast out of the tribe by doing so. These outcasts may have sought to kidnap or kill village people out of revenge or in a desire to create their own tribe. It was a commonly known tradition in the region of some tribes that some tribes raided the tribes for kidnapping people for slavery, or for gathering wives for themselves. There's a much easier and actually cheaper to get a wife by stealing her than by paying for her. Stories of Stick Indians would have been terrifying to children, cautioning them against wandering alone in the night in the forest. These cautionary stories were told in the winter times at night and were very important for keeping the children alive. These stories might also access older history of the tribes where there were migrations of Native people throughout the land. These migrations would consist of groups of questing Native peoples who would be homeless and landless for a time. They were looking for an area to settle and call home. In this region alone, there was lots of movement of tribes every few thousand years. Some time ago, the Malala are said to have moved into the Cascades, and the Klickitat were said to have moved westward, pushed there perhaps by the Plateau peoples. Many of the Athabascan tribes moved into the region relatively recently, perhaps 800 to 1200 years ago. Tallawa stories address their voyage by canoes from the frozen north to lands in northern California. From there, they spread out. Many of these tribes are relatively stable in the region, but as climatic events occurred, as areas were colonized and new technologies discovered, changes came to the tribes. Among many tribes, there are stories of monsters and lakes. They are part of most tribal traditions. They instill fear in all Indians, which is perhaps why many Native people do not like to swim. One set of stories is told by the Tualatin Kalapuya people. These people inhabited the Tualatin Valley, the western section of the Willamette Valley. The Tualatin were a powerful tribe with good connections with the Clackamas peoples and strong leaders. Many of their people inhabited some 20 villages and towns in the vicinity of Wapato Lake. The lake was perhaps the largest resource of Wapato Indian potato in the region. The tribal women would lever up Wapato bowls from the bottom of the lake into their canoes as a principal source of food. The lake is gone now. It's been drained to make way for agriculture in the region. The 12 of the people have a story of a water being who lived in Wapato Lake. This being would periodically come out of the water and was large enough to eat the leaves and the tops of the trees. They say it had big horns and was spotted. It would sometimes steal children. This would instill fear. This instilled fear in the lurks, what lurked in the deeps of the lakes, and helped encourage young people not to venture too far into the water. The Santiam Kalapuya people lived in the central Willamette Valley, and perhaps the most powerful tribe in the valley. When treaty negotiators came to Champui, the Santiam leaders were so powerful that the other Kalapuya tribes joined with them and allowed them to negotiate all of their treaties. They held out for a permanent reservation in the center of their vast area, an area that encompassed Salem, Albany, and Brownsville. Their seasonal hunting camps would take them into the Cascades, where they would camp in forest meadows near lakes and rivers. They have a story of an elk monster who lived in the lake. The elk monster was large enough that a grown man could stand inside his ribcage. The story tells us that one day the elk monster came from the depths of a lake and a young man shot arrows at it and killed it. He told his grandfather about the dead elk-like monster, and the men went back to the next day and camped in the hollow of its ribcage. They cooked the monster from inside to out. And then, as they did this, the waters began to rise, and the area began to flood, and they forced the people to move to higher ground. We do not know today of such creatures in the forest, not for real. But we do know that in the distant past, most of our peoples hunted the megafauna with large spear points of obsidian. They used spears and atlatls to hunt down and kill these monster animals. Some now say we hunted them to extinction. Others say a meteorite caused their demise. Somewhere in my studies, there was a discussion of the fact that a pygmy variety of mammoth survived on an island in the North Pacific until just a few hundred years ago. Regardless, these stories tell us about the experiences of Native people who have lived in this area, the Willamette Valley, and especially river valleys for about 15,000 years. This to us is about 50,000 generations of our people. The stories are the experiences of our long ago ancestors that they encountered the last of the megafauna. They're at times combined with stories of catastrophic events in the history of our people, of the people. The elk monster encounter is combined with a flood, which causes changes in the way people live for a time. These nearly racial memories of strange and mysterious creatures from some time long ago help us understand that people, when they're trying to make sense of the world around them, make up stories. Unexplainable events are caused by something equally monstrous and inexplicable. In addition, a ray of truth exists for all these stories. The fact that Native people knew about monstrous creatures by either listening to stories from their own storytellers or seeing the remains of the megafauna erupting from the earth as in bones, and imagining the creature may have inhabited those bones. Regardless, the stories tell us that Native people were just as imaginative and interesting and explained and inexplicable as people today.
Okay. Well, welcome. And I am actually quite impressed. I have taught classes this big, but they didn't have couches to sit on. Thank goodness. Earlier this evening, a young man came up to David and I, and he told us a story about how Seagull stole the sun. And whenever somebody tells you a story, you always pay that person for the story. And I'm expecting all of you to pay me a beer later. But I'd like to call up that young man so I can pay him. can't do that. What's your name?
Jack.
Jack is the storyteller. You have a long, long life of storytelling ahead of you. Here you go. Jack is now wearing a dentalium necklace. Dentalium, if you didn't know, is old money. It doesn't work in slot machines, but it's what all of our wives wore, what the men wore to distinguish ourselves as far as status goes. So people who wore lots of dentalium necklaces had lots of money and were very well established and were very powerful. Now I'm a little bit poorer. David and I actually, when we were asked to do this, David and I said, yeah, absolutely, we'd love to come up and tell a couple of stories. David and I have known each other for about 20 years, 20 plus years now. In fact, we were graduate students together at the University of Oregon. Any Beaver fans in here? Get out! Get out! I actually lettered in baseball at OSU, but I don't tell anybody. But we were graduate students together, shared an office, and over the years we have collected many, many stories from our elders, from people much older than us, and now we are old that we are passing these things on to other people. One of the things, and as you noticed, as David was telling his stories, he was mentioning a lot of places on the landscape. And when you're telling Native American stories, in particular Oregon Indian stories, they are always intimately tied to a landscape. And it's because the places hold our memories. No matter how long we've been gone, if we return back to those places, the stories come back to us. The places tell us those stories. So whenever we're telling, whether it be coyote stories or clam stories or Bigfoot stories, it's because some part on the landscape reminds us of those things. And that's what I go through when I'm telling stories. I think about the places that they are from, and I go through all of the, where the tree, where Coyote got stuck in, with the fire where he jumped over and he caught his tail on fire. I think of those locations when I'm trying to tell the story. So if you can imagine, we're at a disadvantage here. If you can imagine watching an action movie with only a green screen behind you, that's the disadvantage that we're at. Now, if we were at the location where the story took place, I could point things out to you, and this is where that happened, and this is where that happened, and everything would make sense. It's a much fuller portrait when you tell a story at a place. That is the small print at the bottom of the program. The first story, and all I'm gonna do is tell a couple of stories. So, the first story that I'm gonna tell is one that my father told as he was teaching me how to dig clams. How many people have dug clams before? Yeah, the rest of you are from California. I just lost half of my beer buying crap. Well, I grew up on South Slough of Coos Bay, right next to the Prefontaines. I grew up next to Mark Helfrich. I did not. They wish they grew up next to me. But I grew up on South Slough, Coos Bay, right on the water, right where my family has lived for 10,000 years. Not very many people can say that, but we've lived there forever. And every time the tide would go low, it was time to go out and dig clams. And so this is how my father taught me to dig clams. We would go walking out onto the mud flats where the clam beds were, and he'd look down at the mud and he said, "That reminds me of when clam got its eyes. It was a long, long time ago, and the seagull boys would swoop on down, and the clams were living right on top of the mud. They'd swoop on down, they'd pick up the clam, and they'd bring them over to the hard pan clay. They'd drop them onto the clay, break his shell, and eat them all up." Now, the seagull boys still do that today. They just take it over to the pavement and they drop it on the pavement. And they kept on doing this over and over and over, and pretty soon the clams were becoming so small and so few of them that they didn't know what to do. And finally, when the tide came in, they had a great council. And all of the clams got together and they said, "You know what? If we don't do something, those seagull boys are going to eat us all up and we'll be no more. What should we do?" And they thought and they thought and they thought. And one of the clams, one of the bravest clams, said, "I'll tell you what, we should all dig underneath the mud. And when the tide goes out, we'll be under the mud and the seagull boys won't be able to find us." So at the next low tide, they all dug underneath the mud. And the seagull boys circled around, and there were no clams to be found. The tide came back in, but the clams were underneath the mud. They didn't know it was time to come up and eat. And it went out, and it came back in, and it went out. The tide kept on going in and out, and the clams got hungry and hungry, and finally they all came up, and they said, "Oh my gosh, we didn't know the tide was coming in. We've got to do something different. I'm going to trip and fall on this cord. That'll be good for that camera right there." So the clams got together and they held another great council. And one of the clams said, "I've got an idea. I will stay on top of the mud. The rest of you dig underneath the mud. And I'll stay on top. And when the tide comes in, I will come and get you." And the clam said, "Oh, that's a wonderful idea." So they all dug themselves underneath the mud at the next low tide, and one brave clam was on top. And of course, the tide went out, and the seagull boys, they saw that clam on top of the mud, and they swooped down, they picked him up, and they took him over to the hard pan clay. They dropped and broke his shell and ate him all up. The tide came in and out and in and out and in and out. And pretty soon the clams got tired again. And they got so hungry and they came up to the top and they said, "Oh my gosh, where was he? He was supposed to tell us when to come up to eat." And obviously he had been eaten himself. So they thought and they thought and they thought, "What should we do? I've got an idea," said one of the clams. "I'll stay up on top of the mud, only this time I'm going to stay underneath the seaweed. And then the seagull boys will not see me." And so he got himself underneath the seaweed. The tide went out. The clams went underneath the mud. And the seagull boys circled around, and they circled around. And pretty soon they figured out that that lump underneath that seaweed was a clam. And they took the seaweed off, they picked the clam up, and they took him over to the hard pan clay, they dropped him onto the hard pan mud, broke his shell, and ate him all up. The tide went in and out, and in and out, and in and out, and finally the clams came to the surface. Said, "Where is he?" And obviously he had been eaten. Finally, the clams got together again and said, "We must do something or we will be no more." And they began to think and think and think. And pretty soon, the oldest and wisest of all the clams spoke up. And he said, "Together, we need to work together and use all of our magic and grow eyes. If we grow eyes, we can dig underneath that mud. And then we'll be able to see out through that mud until the tide comes back in." So at the next low tide, they all dug underneath the mud, and they poked their little eyes up to look around. And of course, the seagull boys circled around. They didn't see any clams at all. And the little eyes were just peeking around, and as soon as the tide came in, they saw that it was time to get something to eat, and they came up and got something to eat. Now, for those of you who have dug clams before, you know that clams are bivalves. They spit water out, they suck water in, and it leaves two little eyes. And that's what my father told me as we were digging clams. I was about 4 years old when he told me that story. Is about Bigfoot. Now, Bigfoot is real. He's even got his own reality show. Run by Californians. Not making any friends. This Bigfoot stories and similar stories like this are told at night. And like David said, a lot of stories are told at night. Coyote stories in particular are told in the wintertime. And if you break that taboo, then it rains the next day. And we could certainly use the rain. I'm not going to break that taboo. But Bigfoot stories are usually told in a way that you might normally tell ghost stories at a campfire. And the reason why you do this is important life lessons for your children. Now, my kids growing up, I have two daughters, 14 and 16. very much enjoyed this story, but it was too short for them. I used to tell stories right before they go to bed, and they usually like the longer stories before bed. But this was a shorter version, so I always had to tell this story with another story. And this is how to kill Bigfoot. A long, long time ago, there were lots of Bigfoot, especially in this area. And they used to eat everything with no consequence. Animals, trees, humans, everything that they could get their hands on, they would eat. But their most favorite was drinking the blood out of an Indian's heart. How's that sandwich now? And they roamed and were so numerous that everything was petrified when it came to Bigfoot. They had big, long trails that looked just like this eye. So you knew exactly where they were, and you stayed away from them. If they caught you, you knew that you were dead. They'd rip your heart out and they'd drink the blood. They'd kill you, they'd eat you, they'd torture you. Bigfoot is the reason the hair on the back of your neck stands up. Whenever you hear something behind you but don't see anything, it's Bigfoot. All the Indian children know this. All of the Indians got together and they said, "These Bigfoot, they're eating us all up. We have to do something. We have to figure out a way to kill them." Now, they had tried before. They had stabbed him in the chest. They'd stabbed him in the head, and they'd cut their legs, and they'd cut them in the arms, and they'd done all kinds of things to these Bigfoot. But never were they able to kill a Bigfoot. They were very, very frustrated. And so they held this great council, and they all began to think, what should we do about these Bigfoot? One of the bravest of the Indians stood up and said, I think I have a plan. I have to figure out how to get them to tell us how to kill themselves. And all of them looked over and said, really? That's your plan? So he decided to go out and figure out how to kill the Bigfoot. And he went to a path similar to this, and he laid down on it and pretended to be dead. He laid there, and he waited, and no sooner than he saw and heard these Bigfoot coming. And pretty soon there's a Bigfoot, and he looked down at that puny human, and he poked him with a stick, and he didn't move. And he poked him with his hand, and he didn't move. And he laughed and laughed and laughed and said, these Indians are just dying at the very sight of me. And he reached down and he picked him up and he threw him over his shoulder and he walked to his longhouse. Once he got to his longhouse, there was this big circle door and he put his foot through it and he ducked down and he got inside and he threw the Indian down by the fire pit. And he looked around and he was looking for some firewood and he didn't have any firewood. He goes, oh, I better go get some firewood. So he went out, he ducked down again and got out and went out to get some firewood. That Indian, as soon as Bigfoot left, jumped up and he looked around, all around this huge longhouse, and he looked for the biggest knife that he could find. And he found that big knife and he stood next to that door and he waited for that Bigfoot to come back. He really didn't know what he was going to do. And all of a sudden, this foot came coming in, and then this other Bigfoot came in. It was Bigfoot's son. And he reached over and he grabbed Bigfoot's son by the head, and he held that knife up to him, and he said, tell me where your father's heart is. And the son was terrified, being startled, and had this knife to his throat. And he said, my father's heart is in his heel, his left heel. And so the Indian let him go. Pretty soon, the Bigfoot came in, and that big left heel came in, and the Indian stabbed him right in the heel, and Bigfoot fell over dead, right there in the middle of the longhouse. Even though he was dead, he could still speak, and he said, I will eat you forever! The Indian laughed and laughed and laughed because he was laying there dead, yelling, I will eat you forever, I will eat you forever. And finally he thought to himself, well, we better make sure that he doesn't eat us forever. And he told the Bigfoot, I'm going to cut you into little pieces, I'm going to burn you up in the fire. So he gathered all of the wood that the Bigfoot had brought in. And he built this huge fire. And then the Bigfoot was over there yelling, I will eat you forever, I will eat you forever. And he began to chop him up. And every time he chopped a little bit of piece of the Bigfoot up, he threw him in the fire. And pretty soon, all that remained was this huge pile of ash. The Indian looked at the ash and he thought, I better make sure that that ash doesn't come back to life somehow. I don't know. So he grabbed all the ash and he took it outside and he said, I'm going to scatter you to the four corners of the world. And he began to throw the ash up into the air. And he threw it up in the air and it was swirling around, all of this ash swirling. And he threw screw it all up, and pretty soon there is this big swirl of ash, and he could hear this buzzing noise. And then he felt a little sting on his arm, and there was a little mosquito going, "I will eat you forever." Yes, we still have Bigfoot. Now, I don't know how you want to end this.
Coyote story.
How about an encore? How's that?
Yeah.
Every single one of our names means we are from here. The Coquille, originally our name was sheep equipments, which means from the Eagle River. Unfortunately, they interviewed, an ethnographer interviewed somebody from the Coos area and asked them, well, what do you call those people down there? Well, we call them Coquilles, which in their language meant eel. And Coquille, you know, Coquille, then it was Coquille, and then the French moved in and said Coquille. French Californians. But everything begins when there was no light, and when the earth was separated, and it was all brought together. There were two old men sitting in a longhouse. The older of the two looked across the fire as he was smoking his pipe and thought to himself, should I eat him today? No, not today. And he commanded the other man, he said, go outside and check and see if it's time. The old man got out, went outside, and he looked around, and all he could see were waves and waves and violent waves. He came back inside and he says, yes, I think it's time we did something. The old man got up and he went back out and he looked outside. And he saw these violent waves. So he reached in his pocket and he pulled out a disc of mud, of clay. And he threw it out into the water. And it sat down on the waves and it held it for a little bit. And then the waves broke it up into all kinds of different pieces. So the old man reached down and he grabbed two discs. And he threw it out there and they sat on top of the waves. And they shook for a little bit, and then the waves broke them all up. The old man thought, and he thought, and he thought. And he told the other old guy, go in and get my basket mat. Went into the longhouse, he got the basket mat. And he reached down and grabbed a couple of discs of clay, and he threw it out there on top of the water, began to shake, and then he threw his mat on top of the clay. And that mat held that clay together, and the waves crashed on top of that mat and gently sifted through. And that's how land was created, through that mat. So he threw more discs of clay and more mats, and pretty soon the waters and land were separated. He looked upon it and he said, this is good. Now the people to come will have the place to be. So they looked on top of that land and they surveyed what they had done. And the old man thought to himself, people will be lonely if we don't give them animals. So he reached into his hair and he pulled out a strand of hair and he threw it onto the ground and it became a snake. And this snake became two snakes, became four snakes, became eight snakes. And pretty soon there was a land full of snakes and those snakes became animals. And elk and deer and bear and birds. And all the animals were created out of the hair and the snakes. The old man looked at it and he thought, this is good. People won't be lonely and they'll be well fed. But that's not enough. So he looked around and he said, we need to create other people. And they walked up and down the beach, up and down the beach. And they began to think about how to create other people when all of a sudden they looked up and they saw this old medicine man. He was on a snag and he was just sitting on the end of this snag. And the two old men looked up at him and said, what are you doing here? This is our land. We made it. He said, oh no, I've been here from the beginning. No, you haven't. We created the land. We created the animals. This is our land. We created it. And they were so mad, they shook that snag, and finally the old man fell down. They ripped off his arms, and they threw it to the north. And those arms became the people of the north. They ripped off his legs. They threw him down south. And those became the Californians. People of the south. They took his body, his torso, they threw it to the east and became all of the people of the east. And all that remained was this bloody stain. And from this bloody stain came a woman, a beautiful woman. And she became the mother of the Coquilles. They looked around and they thought, this is good. We have created all the people. We have created land. There's water. There's animals. This is good. But we really can't see everything that we've created. So they thought to themselves, how are we going to be able to see everything? And the younger of the old men said, I've got an idea. You shoot an arrow up, and then I'll shoot an arrow right behind yours, and it will stick right in yours. And we'll keep doing this, and pretty soon we'll have a big, long row of arrows. And then we'll be able to go up there and see. That sounds like a good idea, the old man said. So they began to shoot arrows up into the sky, and pretty soon they had this big, long rope of arrows all the way up into the sky. And just as they thought they had solved all the problems, they both reached for the arrows. And they both looked at each other and they said, well, I just thought I was going to go first. Well, no, I created all of the people. It was my hair. I should go first. And they began to argue back and forth, back and forth. Well, the younger one was much... well, he was smarter, let's say. And he said, fine, you go first. And so he started to climb and climb and climb. And by the time he got up there, it was dark. And he became the moon. And even though he was bright, he couldn't see anything because it was dark down there. And the other guy, he became the sun, and that's how time began.
If folks have, thank you so much. If folks have a few questions about storytelling, then our speakers will be willing to answer, I think.
Hi, for David. So you were talking about how the water represented fear and monsters. And in a lot of cultures, stories, water also represents birth. And I'm wondering, in particular Santiam culture, if water represents other things other than monsters.
Yeah, there's different time periods.
Just repeat the question.
You're asking about different what water means in different tribes, basically with the Santiam. So there are different time periods of the earth. So water can mean different things at different time periods. Native people, most tribes separate time by, well, nowadays before colonization, after colonization. Before that, it was a time when animals and birds and everything could talk, and there was times before that when things were being created. And so water means different things in different languages. Yes. Questions?
I'm wondering about who tells stories in what kind of tribes, in terms of, is it typically males or females, or is it, does every family have a storyteller, or does the community have a storyteller?
Anybody who knows the story. These days, the reality is that we have to tell the stories over and over and over and over, so that people will remember them. And in more traditional times, there would be story performers, and just like an acting troupe. And they were the actors, they would tell the stories, but we have lost so many people that it's really important that if you hear a story, you are being told that story so that you will remember, and that's your responsibility. And so part of that practice is to tell the story. Once you've been given the story, you tell the story.
I guess, first of all, how old are most of the stories, and are new stories created in this generation?
Actually, Jason and I were kind of talking about this at dinner tonight. One of the stories that I was thought we were talking about is how the Coquilles and some of the Western urban tribes kept after this goal of restoration and of being recognized as tribes and getting their due, because the federal government had not paid them fairly for the land, because most all the coastal tribes didn't get a treaty, and so they never got paid for the land until, you know, really the 20th century. So we were talking about that. That was an example of a contemporary story that was passed on for three or four, perhaps five generations of the Coquille and Coos peoples. And that carried them through to eventually going after restoration and becoming restored. So yes, there are contemporary stories like that of the tribes are passing on and not being their dues. There are also very old stories too. Like some of the ones I was mentioning, the Klamath is probably a 7,000-year-old story of them seeing Mazama lose the fight, and which is basically a dual volcanic event probably, and the crater, the top of the mountain falling inside the crater. So they actually, it's an eyewitness account of that happening.
There's a fairly prominent story from Bandon in a Face Rock. If you're familiar with that, Face Rock, that story is about 5,000 to 6,000 years old, and we've been telling it for that long, and that's how long that rock's been standing there. But then there's also, as equally as important, some stories that are told that are only 150 years old. And so I'll quickly tell this, and everybody who left just misses. Some of the earliest Europeans that came through were the Spanish, and the Spanish moved their way up from the south and made their way to the mouth of the, we always say Coquille because that's what the French call it, the Coquille River. And when these new arrivers came, as was tradition, you hold a great feast. And so lots of Indians came from all over the place. The Coos came down from the Coos River. The Tolowa came up from southern Oregon, northern California. Everybody came over. And the Spanish brought with them a new food to share with us at this feast, and it was beans. And so they boiled these beans, and they were a foreign, after a long boil, they were palatable. So, it was a foreign food, but everybody was happy to have something new. It was probably 3-4 years later that the British came and landed on the North Spit of Coos Bay, and or maybe it was the Americans. And they brought with them beans as well. Now the Coos had seen how the Spanish were preparing the beans down the Coquille River. So they said, we'll cook these up. We know how to do this. So they grabbed those beans and they boiled them. They poured off the water. They tried to eat them, but they were still hard. So they put more water in there and boiled them. And they kept doing it over and over and over, pouring the water out. And finally, they got frustrated and just tossed the beans. And the Americans were frustrated as well because the Coos didn't know how to make coffee. Now, this is where it becomes interesting. Whenever a Coquille wants to insult the Coos, we just say, "You guys don't even know how to make coffee." And that's lived for 150 years. Back to the Missoula flood.
I was trying to tell a few of those. There are some stories. In my talk, I talked about how the beaver is said to have walked down the Columbia and dragged his tail behind him. The story is much more extensive than what I told, but basically that's what he did. He supposedly has walked down the Columbia River Gorge, dragged his tail, and created the gorge from that. That's one of the stories. The other one was the fight between coyote and beaver. And they fought through the area and created the gorge by their fighting. And that basically created the gorge. And then the coyote won and scattered beaver all over the place and created tribes. And so that's two of the stories. The second one is more common and it's in various versions. And one of the versions has coastal people with big mouths and. Any other questions? You're asking how native storytelling may contribute to community as well as perhaps personal health?
Yeah.
Well, I guess you stay alive if you do what the story tells you to do. You're going to the forest, don't get grabbed by stick Indians,
One of the, and you know what, this is common all over the globe, different perceptions about sex. And taboos. There are lots of stories about things to be aware of. And a lot of them have to do with Coyote, and he is a very oversexed being. And so I think, when I think of Coquille youth and Coquille girls, we're not so afraid of what sex means and what some of the dangers are out there, because the stories themselves teach you. You're more exposed to those kinds of things. So I would say, in that respect, there are some advantages of knowing the lessons in the stories. As far as, you have to think of stories in two different ways. Sometimes they give you lessons, but most of the time stories are just entertainment. And so you shouldn't always look for and it's really common for people to try to find meaning in every single story. It's not that way. And many times it's just entertainment.
Use the word Indian, and I heard that to be PC, you should say Native American. Can you comment on that?
This is, and I, you know, you use Indian just to be expedient, as a luxury, and because I can get wet. But this is how I taught my students in New York, who were didn't know a whole lot about Native Americans, even though they were surrounded by the Haudenosaunee and the Iroquois nations, is that when you're in a foreign country, and you're in France, and somebody says, oh, where are you from? You say, oh, I'm from the United States. Oh, where in the United States? Oh, I'm from New York. Oh, where are you? I'm from Rochester. Oh, where in Rochester? Oh, Spencerport. From then on, you're from Spencerport, you're not from the United States. People know you as this. The very same is true about Native Americans, all right? Indians, Native Americans, American Indians is very acceptable. But it's also dangerous too, because Native Americans, you know, people sometimes say, well, because I was born in America, I'm a Native American. American Indians, well, you might be Asian American, but you're from America, so you're American Indian. What we prefer is that once you know he's Kalapuya from the Grand Ronde, that's how you call him, that's how you refer to him. Anything less, it's a slight. Once you know that I am Coquille, or that I am Mishikotma today, in fact, I'm gonna hold you all today. That's where I am from, because all of our names mean we are from here. And that is the PC, is to call somebody by their federally recognized tribe and or by American Indian or Alaska Native until you find out where they're from.
Thank you.
All right, beer time.